I'm going to tell you some of my story this evening, but a lot of the time that doesn't feel like me. Thank you, a warm thank you to Professor Catherine Cassell, also to Professor Jane Holgate, and to Kat Rini, who is, I think, outside, and to also to Sean Chaplin for the help in bringing me here. A fantastic opportunity to talk to you. Being heard is so important. I can't hear myself, however. I'm very deaf. And I wanted to say, first of all, if anybody can't catch what's being said, please wave. How is it at the moment? Any? Ooh. We have Laura Bradbury, stand up, Laura. She's, the lovely Laura, she's good. Rightly, she's a lip speaker, not a sign interpreter. She's repeating English in a way that I can lip read and adding in a few elements of sign language. So if you ask questions, you have queries, I will look at Laura and understand her. Any questions before I start? I've met a few of you already. First thing to say, thank you. It's January, it's cold, it's dark, and you turned up. Yeah. So no pressure. So this evening, I'm supposed to be talking about corporate wisdom. So imagine getting the phone call. Hello, would you like to give a lecture about corporate wisdom? What would you say? Aye. The two words. It's quite frightening, don't you think? Well, I think my response to Kathy was, well, I'm not really corporate, and I'm definitely not white. She said, it's okay, give the talk anyway. So, but there's actually something serious in there. My reptilian brain said, go, disappear. My neocortex, my more modern brain said, hang on a moment, Joan. Maybe you have something to offer. Actually, seriously, when I started to think about the experiences I've had, I thought, at the moment, we need ways to stop being afraid. I don't know if anybody's scared at the moment. You're feeling frightened about the changes in the world, the developments. I think a lot of recent politics and decisions have been driven by fear. Do you agree with me? I feel that. When we're fearful, we're on. Like corporate wisdom, I thank you. And when I thought about it carefully before replying to Kathy, I thought the one gift that my experience has given me is to stop being afraid, especially to stop being afraid of fitting in too much. Stop being afraid of what other people think. My Lancastrian grandmother, what would folk think? What would folk think? She spent her life worrying about that. So this evening, I've made some slides, of course, to show you. I want to make this interesting for you. I don't believe it's possible to listen to somebody talking for 45 minutes and for you to concentrate for all that time, because your mind will be thinking about far more important things like, so how much time's left on the parking meter? Is there any food left in the kitchen? So for this reason, I've done two things. The first is to base the talk around questions I think you may have, you'd want answered by me. And the second is to include sections for you to discuss. You have to have discussion. That's all of you and your neighbours, who you may not know. Could be scary. So, simple question to start with. What is exclusion? I'm sure we could all give a basic definition, but I'm going to use that question to talk to you about the real impact of exclusion. That includes the emotional impact. Second question. And a big one for you. Welcome, new guests. How can you develop resilience? It's a very popular word at the moment. This is resilience for you. others may well be resilient for your businesses, your organisations. If you have resilient people, you get more resilient organisations. So the two together. Third question, how do you develop a successful social enterprise? I have a colleague over here, the handsome gentleman with the beard, is Hormuz Ahmadzadeh. He's supporting me this evening, thank you, Hormuz. And we are developing what we hope is a successful social enterprise together. But I've again pulled out some questions. If you're thinking about this, what you need to ask yourself. Finally, and perhaps most importantly, what does this actually mean for you? And how can it help you? Does that sound like a reasonable structure? Any questions before we get going? I'd welcome questions all the way through. It makes it feel more natural. Questions? Okay, so starting with the first topic, then, what is exclusion? To answer that question, I think we need to think about the worlds we are in. If we feel we fit in, we feel comfortable, comfy, we don't feel excluded. So to answer that question, I needed to think, well, which world is mine? Which is your world? I'm making a guess that we're from many different countries in this room, which is wonderful. We bring different perspectives. The more worlds you can feel comfortable in, the greater the number of perspectives you have. If you've lived in more than one country, like several of you, you can think about your own country from the UK or from Uganda or from wherever you come from. Some pictures, some snapshots for you, a few of my worlds. First one. Music. This is actually a music stand, in case you're wondering. It's not a high-tech device, it's just a music stand because I can keep eye contact with you. But I use it to put music on, and I play music. And Cathy kindly mentioned this was where I started in life. It's my first job. So playing music. Do we have any musicians in the house or singers? Put your hand up for a musician. We have one over here. Another one. Any more? Only two? I don't believe you. We have a cellist over there, and it's not quite the same as asking if you have a doctor in the house, but you never know when you might need a good tune. So, on a serious note, if you are a musician, for the people here, it can be hard to convey how important that is for you. Music is physical, it's emotional, it's intellectual. It's actually been shown by neuroscientists as one of the best ways to get the whole of your mind alive and working. And it was absolutely at the heart of my life during my younger years. So playing the viola, played in a local youth orchestra, played the National Youth Orchestra, got to travel, got to socialise, and just loved every minute of it. Second picture. This represents teaching, which is also an important part of me and a part of my world. The lady here is receiving an award in the name of my mum, and she's from the Workers' Educational Association. She's a grandmother who'd been separated from her children and grandchildren for 7 years. She hadn't been able to contact them, and she'd been using the time to learn. And this was very moving to present the award for Lifelong Learner of the Year. That's me in the background, because that lady summed up for me the point that education is so important. It's probably the only thing that nobody else can take away from you. So I know many of you here are getting a good education, absolutely crucial. Then we have two pictures. I'm sorry, this was a bit of a bad hair day. Polish hairdressers. The next two pictures were from my work as a diplomat. But that's another thing I never expected to be saying. My Cathy said she was a diplomat. Was I? I really, really was for 10 whole years. But the role I took in Poland was head of something called the political military team. So there, I was observing a military exercise in eastern Poland, near the border with Ukraine. I think I was the only woman that day, find myself in that situation. And it was fascinating work. I was head of a team of 12, and really I was with military people. I learned so much from that. and I was also using Polish every day, using Polish language. Next picture, same bad hair, sorry. So you can say it's still Poland. The man in the picture, his name is Jarosław Duda, and he was a Polish minister for people with disabilities. Lovely, lovely man. And it's just near the end of my posting, he's presenting me with flowers in the colours of the Polish flag. And he was saying thank you for the work we had developed together with the embassy on legislative reform in Poland. It was actually reforming disability rights legislation there. So I was really lucky not just to have a personal relationship with the minister speaking Polish to him, didn't speak English, but also to have the opportunity to use who I was in an additional and positive way. So if you look at these pictures, all these worlds are quite different. And I'm going to add one more. Oh, looking older. Older but wiser, I hope. Anybody recognize the green bench in the background? Jane? It is. It's the House of Commons. Get me. That was last summer, and I was sitting on a panel, I felt like being at the UN or something, giving oral evidence as a witness at the Parliamentary Select Committee for Work and Pensions. That was about what's called the disability employment gap, 32% difference between the percentages of disabled people employed and non-disabled. So now part of what I do is policy. I did policy in the Foreign Office. And I'm doing policy now as an independent in a way. All these worlds are quite different. And the worlds you've lived in and will live in and exist in and work in will be different. I think the point to make here is they form each other. You learn things from each set of experience. And I try never to take that for granted. Right, two pictures for you now. And I'm going to ask you to vote by putting your hand up. Thinking about how to present this weird and wonderful story of mine, I'm going to try three models. One is visual. So what do you think? Your journey, your route through life, what does it look like to you if you could picture it? So have a look at this picture first. Any of you who've traveled by air, this is familiar, right? You're on the little seat, locked in, and up comes the TV and says, here is your route, vroom. Brilliant. It's so straightforward, is it, sir? Nice line. And if you look very carefully, you'll see it's going from Washington to London, exactly the route the Prime Minister just took recently. I wonder if she ever going to regret that visit. So one way to look at it, look, as the crow flies, flight route. Here's the second picture. A lot more technical, a difference. This is a technical picture. The dark red line is the ideal path from one destination to the other. The orange line and the light red line are showing the possible variation. So it's something called the MR set distance. I'm not interested in the technicalities, but if you're a pilot, what you do, you have the ideal route, okay, from here to Laura, like this. But what happens if between me and Laura there's a thunderstorm or somebody, some other plane has gone the wrong way, there are hazards coming in, you have to go off to avoid them. And then you try to return to the best possible route. My suggestion, this is another metaphor for life, that we try things, we might go off kilter, try that, not good, come back. And the pilot is minimizing error. You're trying to find your path, the right way for you. So let's vote. You have two choices, the route or the negotiated flight path. Let's have votes, please. Think about this. Who feels that life is a route? Hands up. We have two people. Yes, three, thank you. Thank you. Anybody have four? Yes. Five, thank you. Thank you, that's fine. Yeah, six, about six. Thank you. Who would go for the negotiated flight path as the route to me? Yeah. So we have a lot of people voting for that. Why is that? It's like both of you are right, there's no right and wrong. But why do you think more people chose the second one? Yes.
Because there are too many unpredictable things during your whole life. It is not possible
Absolutely.
To find a some specific life role.
Absolutely. Absolutely, thank you. There are, but you may be at a stage of life when you haven't had those things happening yet, which is great. And it's up to us how we approach things and what we choose. So there's one way of showing how a story happened. Mine was definitely negotiation path. Lots of barriers, lots of thunderstorms and rocks, you name it, really, things came in my way. You know about some of them. Another way to look at this could be like this. Some starts and some stops, starts and stops in sign language. We have a sign language user here, I know. So a quick nip through. I've mentioned music and teaching being important from 6 to 18, 22. Then I got to go and learn at Cambridge University. I got an idea when I was 12, studying at my local comprehensive school. I liked the idea of going to Cambridge. I had no idea what it was like, really. And they let me in. And then the trouble started. I think I'm tall. Do you think I'm tall?
Yes.
Got to Cambridge, they're all about this. Joan Duffner, so she used to be my boss as well. But Cambridge, they're all about this high. I got neck-ache looking at them. And they're all men, it seemed. So I studied there in 1987. And at St. John's, my college, I was only the third year of women. That was a strange experience, coming from a state mixed school. That was the start of learning how to deal with exclusion, anyway. The next stop, a big thing, age 24, was becoming deaf. And that's the thing you just do not want to hear, isn't it? Ha ha, that wasn't that joke. There's lots of pitfalls, language about deafness. But seriously, the worst thing that could happen, happened. And for 6 years after that, no music. It was too painful. I can't even start to describe to you what that was like. That was definitely the worst aspect of becoming deaf. But the interesting thing was actually the deafness acted as what I call a quality filter for relationships with people I would have later on. That might sound perverse, but you ask yourself, will somebody meet me halfway? I can't hear now. I need to lip read. I might need support. I might need to learn to communicate differently. If you value me, won't you meet me halfway? So I discovered at that point that the man I was with was the wrong one. Failed the test. The thing that saved me as I became deaf at work. If you don't work, how do you live? I don't have any money of my own, no wealth. So I carried on teaching further education. And one of the places I worked, actually when I became deaf, was in Poland. That's where I started to hear Polish. That gave me the foundations of learning Polish sounds. I then made a sideways move. I'm like a crab, I move sideways a lot rather than up into editing. But this was about using the experience I had. I've been teaching English as a foreign language, trying to use it in a different context. Learned to be an editor. That was where I met Jane Holgate, in fact, many years ago, about 20 years ago now. Editing was a useful skill to pick up, partly because of project management, learning to handle various stages of a project. And it was very deaf-friendly. But deaf-friendly didn't mean it was best for me. One thing for you to think about, especially students of human resources, should people do a job because it's easy to fit them in a box, oh, she's deaf, give her something to read. Because I could do it, okay, but it wasn't using the best bits of me. Sadly, that job was also where I experienced prejudice at work. So, waiting for my second editorial job. I've gone through various tests and checks, interviews, written tests, and was told 2 days, you'll get the answer. And how long do you think I had to wait? They said 2 days, yes. They're fucked. actually had the script. Actually, it was about exactly 2 months. It's not, what's going on? 2 months. Strange. Very strange. I didn't know until later what the reason was. Now, call me naive, maybe constructively naive, but it took 2 months. Okay, here's the job. Great. What I discovered a bit further down the line was the person in charge didn't want a deaf person working here. That were the words. I don't want a deaf person working here. So there's like a generic description. It's a sort of sinister thought that you're being judged, not on being able to do the exercises, the interview. They had a good scoring system at the place we worked, but the fact I was deaf. And I think that's resonance now. Think about the language being used at the moment in the news, our new US president, sign language, Trump. It's a nice sign, Trump. He's basically saying, I don't want people from these bad countries. The whole country, all these 7 countries, they're all bad. In a way, the boss was saying, you're from a bad country. She couldn't. She was fearful. She was afraid of the difference, afraid of somebody who had a disability that she didn't know. So that was bad, but it led to something good, because I wanted to move on. And I applied to the Foreign Office. Why did you go from that to that? So now the honest answer, there was a good advert in the newspaper. And at that point, Britain was very pro-diversity, very pro-representation from society, good representation. And I thought, I can do these things. I've worked abroad. I worked as a musician in Finland. I set up a school in Poland, in West Poland. I've learned languages. I've got management, project management. Let's try for it. Little did I know, 1,100 people applied and they were only letting 10 of us in. That was scary. But it was good because I didn't know until I got in. If they'd told me earlier, I would have said, oh, I can't do this. So if I thought that Cambridge was a culture shock, then going to the Foreign Office was a huge culture shock. The men were still this tall, very smart, with ties, all wearing grey suits, it seemed. And I just got used to walking into a room and not only often being the only woman by love, but I came and her with elegant female lip speakers. I said, what's that? Who's she? I remember going into a counter-terrorism conference discussion and all eyes around. I was wearing a bright red jacket and I felt like some kind of exotic bird. Hi, guys. But fantastic opportunity, right from day one, seeing things from a new perspective. The policy makers, the decision makers, communication spot on there. How do you communicate really, really succinctly? How do you get across your message in a way that somebody from a completely different culture could understand? Sadly, a few months down the line, there were big losses coming up again. Very suddenly, my mother died. And this was the biggest loss I've ever experienced. You asked me, deafness, I could handle that. Losing mum, that was the tough thing. And it was unfortunate that the boss at the time couldn't really handle emotion. I always found that strange. Diplomacy is about people. And it comes down to it. Policy is written by people. Policy is about people's lives and the decisions they make. So it was a really toxic situation. That boss could only cope with people who were top form. Probably tall men in grey suits, maybe. And I wanted to go, because I had enough. I got on the reptilian brain, wanted to protect myself, I was grieving. But the neocortex said, hang on. Don't leave yet. So I took some time away, about 7 months, did a bit of teaching, comfort zone, and then thought, I'll go back on my terms. I'm going back with a different attitude. The gift that I got from the loss of my parent was I would do things on my terms. If they could give me what I needed in terms of a career, I would give them as much as I could. So I ignored what people told me, the jobs I should be doing. If we're doing policy, you should be doing bilateral relations. I said, no, I want to do the annual report. What? The annual report? Career death. But there's an important message in there. I'd been an editor. I'd worked with Joan and others. I had the skills. So the White Paper, Foreign Office Annual Report was a great way to use those skills. Plus, I got nosy and talked to all the departments. They really hated me. It was so annoying. I'm saying, that's not clear. We want the plain English campaign version. What? We've never done that before. We don't do it that. We're doing it that way now. I've also mentioned the health. I mean, this sounds like I'm making it up, but just as I was coming out of my grief and recovering emotionally, I found myself landed in hospital. I'd overworked. I was doing too much work on the report, working late, sitting, not moving, and I didn't know that I had a tendency towards blood clots, and one of the clots was here. I was actually quite close to not being here today talking to you. I was put myself at real risk because of that. So I had a lung clot and a leg clot. I couldn't walk 10 paces without breathing. That was a huge thing to take on. It was almost too much. However, I was inspired because I'd already applied then for a foreign posting. The colleagues who started at the Foreign Office with me were already ahead of me. They're all on postings already. But I decided to apply to Poland. Same thing as with the other thing. I spoke a little bit of Polish, and it would be familiar, and I felt I would be able to use my skills. Getting posting involved doing things other people didn't have to do. So all the candidates trying for the job, and it's very competitive, didn't have to do any tests. I had to do an oral Polish language test. So from several years before, I sat opposite the teacher. I thought, oh, heck, no. But I did it. I got through. I had encouragement. And then a lot of hard work was coming up. To do a job like that, you need to be quite fluent in the language. I needed to be able to say things like, for example. That's a tongue twister. But it's all consonants. Very tricky. But arriving in Poland, do you know what, do you want to know what it means? It means in Shebshishanya, the crickets are making the it's onomatopoeic, the noise with the back of their legs in the grass. I get you a rough translation. The foreign posting was a making of me. It was the work I should be doing, work with people, work with journalists, forming connections with people, building rapport. And doing the work I mentioned earlier about legislative reform. The end of that posting, I was encouraged to apply for a job with more responsibility, a deputy ambassador. Woohoo! Fantastic. Really good job, because when you're a deputy, you have to do everything, basically. It's not just about Foreign Office work, but the full range of British government work, trade, treasury work, you name it, the whole thing, everything from energy issues, you name it. And I really wanted that job. And I was offered the job. And I took advice from senior colleagues to try for less popular jobs. So I apologise to anybody here from Kazakhstan, but that was the job. That was the offer of a job in Kazakhstan. I'm quite sure the fact it was minus 40 degrees in winter had nothing to do with it being unpopular. But getting that job was brilliant. I really wanted to do it. Politically, very interesting. Everything seemed fantastic. And then guess what? As Kathy said, they took it away. I sat first floor of the embassy in Warsaw. I was planning everything. I started to learn Russian. You have to get ahead of the game, you know. I couldn't hear Cyrillic alphabet. And there was one email. Uh-oh. From HR. Sent to the wrong email address. It was in the confidential area behind about seven doors of the embassy, and I was alone. I remember it vividly reading, "We'll be unable to support you doing this posting due to the cost of your support being unreasonable." Right. So that was one of the moments, and I've had many. But the reason that was so tough, it felt like discrimination, you can imagine. I mean, the cost, sure, we could talk about that. But it felt like I was being asked to be a hypocrite. The values which had informed my work were about equality and fairness and justice. And I spent 4 years in Poland standing up in the Polish Parliament, speaking Polish, advocating, representing UK rights law, which works very well. I have law right here, it works well. Deaf and disabled people can do well, and then to be told we're not doing this. what was I supposed to say to Minister Duda? That was really tough. I remember sending an email, forwarding the email to my colleague who was the ambassador in Belarus next door, and I'd done some work as his deputy. And he's a very eloquent gentleman, and he said, "Your email made me so angry, I could hardly bear to read it." So it was nice to have support. But then what do you do next? What do you do? I brought court cases, three altogether, with the support of the Equality and Human Rights Commission, which was wonderful to have. So I challenged the decision, but didn't win. And again, waking up the morning after the decision, thinking, I can't do this. It's too much looking at the ceiling. No, this is all wrong. It felt wrong. But somehow you have to carry on. I made another sideways move, like the crop. 1 year in the social enterprise department at Charity Action on Hearing Loss, when I had a fantastic team who all made life accessible for me, and I started to feel like Jane again. And at that point, people started offering me roles. You talked about the trusteeships, the governance roles. It was an interesting feeling to have been excluded completely, to be told, you know, on the one hand, you're good enough, we want to give you this job, but we're not giving you the support to be left in suspended animation. And on the other hand, the people on the outside were saying, come and work for us. So who was right? Here, I've just put up a few questions, a few of the thoughts. I won't read them out, unless you can't see. But these were some of the really big challenges and challenging questions I had to deal with. Some of you may already have experienced challenges in your life, maybe changes, not necessarily about disability or deafness, other changes. Well, you have to face this type of big questions. There's a really good silver lining, which is your self-awareness develops in a very deep way. You may not realise it at the time, but when you're pushed, you find out how strong you are. So asking those questions, trying to find answers, is part of the ongoing process of increasing knowledge of yourself, knowing yourself really, really well. There's no better gift. If anybody wants copies of the slides, you're welcome. By the way, let me know. We'll send them on to you. We can send them on. One final way of looking at this story is like a businesswoman. Like I'm dressed up like a businesswoman this evening, which is a balance sheet. Losses and gains. So the losses were pretty massive. That's a big one. Huge. Two careers. So you look at that list. This list, if you'd shown me when I was 18, there's like all the things that give life meaning to me. What are the gains? But there are gains. New careers, I was pushed, but I would definitely not have applied to the Foreign Office if the boss who worked with John and I hadn't done that. So thank you, Jude. New networks. Ask Cornwall about my network. He calls me the network queen, but weird and wonderful. If you need a contact, ask me. Because of moving around so much, different ways, you develop contacts. I'm very nosy. I like meeting people. Much deeper self-awareness. And then this kind of inner self-confidence, not needing external approval. That's a big one. Again, it's a balance. You've been told you're out, you're excluded. But that also gives a kind of freedom. I can choose who I am. Definitely a broader perspective. And the other good news, good capacity of happiness. Talk about that but in a moment. So to summarise this bit, I thought there's two ways to look at exclusion. If you accept others' definition of you, then you define yourself by not being in that group, or this one I prefer. They have chosen to exclude me, but I'm the same person. The same person with the same skills and experience. I carry that with me all through life. A nice quote, I like this one. this was important to me. It's not what had happened to me. Things will happen to you. There will be challenges, there will be thunderstorms and obstacles. But it's what you choose to become, is how you deal with them on the flight path. So I had to really dig deep inside myself. Thought, how could I use what I'm best at? What am I best at? What can I do? What are my skills? And now it's over to you on this question for just about 2 minutes. What are your secret skills? What might you be hiding from people? Talking to the person nearest to you, or perhaps two of them. Is there something you are good at, you're not using in your main work or steady role at the moment? How could you use this better? Just 2 minutes with the person next to you, just have a think. Discuss. Sorry that was so short, but I could say several people looking very animated. Any quick feedback about that? Any revelations and insights? Later, maybe? Over a cup of tea? Anybody? No? Thoughts? Yes?
Just going to say that sometimes in our group, we were talking about having a skill that's, it's not work-related, but it's something, well, it was to do, around the show, to do with having skills about growing vegetables, gardening, things like that. And it may be something that you wouldn't think of as a career, but something may happen in your life where you can't do what you used to do, and you pick those skills out of necessity and then you grow. So it's good to know what your skills are.
Absolutely. And it's funny you should mention vegetables. My brother is now an academic, was a chef for the first 12 years of his life. And when he went for his interview at Birmingham, part of the job was managing big conferences. And he was actually able to draw on that experience of being a successful chef. You have to be very good at coordinating. So you could be surprised. Thank you. Good example. Anybody else? Feedback coming on? Yes. No? Yes.
How about cooking?
Cooking as well, the food team this evening. Are you feeling hungry?
I'm not good at networking, but I guess I can, try to do better in cooking and invite friends come to my house and try to build up the networking.
You might get a lot of people coming to your house. Is it a big house? An invitation. But there's actually, seriously, there's no better way of encouraging rapport than eating. We're going to eat together later, which is wonderful. In diplomatic world, people were always eating and drinking because it smooths the conversation. So if you say you don't feel like a natural networker, you give somebody delicious food. It's great. Great way to do it. Thank you. Good examples. Okay, thank you. Moving on. Next. Shorter term, resilience. How do you develop resilience? This is something that you don't set out to do. You don't work up and think, right, today I'm going to become more resilient to you. We don't do that. Resilience is about how you deal with what comes along on the flight path. I said earlier that I'm no longer afraid of fitting in, but I'm now going to slightly contradict that. Sometimes I do feel afraid, and one of the ways to develop resilience is to do scary things. You know this thing about your comfort zone and your stretch zone, but the really scary thing about this is the time. 6:50, that's like before we normally wake up in the morning with a camera on you. Oh my goodness, that was scary. That really happened. You can find out somewhere on the internet. I'm also proud with this one, that this man here, Tony, is a colleague of Laura's. He's a lip speaker. It was the first time ever there'd been a lip speaker shown on camera. And I was there in my capacity as a trustee, talking about the closure of factories, or employee factories, which were quite controversial at the time, and disabled people were losing their jobs. Now, a really scary thing. Please don't laugh. This was done very recently, and I've got to come fiddle with the technology. But I can't tell you how scary this was. Not the technology, but This was a few months ago. That's enough of that. That's not a body double. You know, I'm filming, someone does the stunts, that's me. That's my Ryan Gosling moment. Anybody seen La La Land? You know, Ryan Gosling, it's Land's brother, Joseph, you know. So, if you ask me how long did it take to get to the point to be able to play like that, again, it actually took about 12 years. I was thinking about it. In Poland, I didn't play very much the posting, but I played regularly, encouraged by friends and amateur orchestras, and gosh, it was scary. It was really, really scary. But this develops your resilience. It's about recovering who you are, going back to yourself. The music was in there somewhere. And the interesting thing was, as soon as I started to play again, the music came back in my head. So I can't listen to the radio or tapes, but now I will hear symphonies, songs, things I've played before. Oral memory. More advice on resilience. It's simple. Get help. Ask, ask, ask. Ask yourself, what's the worst thing that can happen? You say, this person thinks she'd make a great mentor. So, will you be my mentor? If you smile sweetly, if you're polite. The worst thing they can say is, I don't have time. 9 times out of 10, somebody will help you. I had coaching. I'm now a coach as well. I still have coaching. Wonderful to be listened to. Wonderful to really reflect on what you're thinking and why. Also, contacts, contacts, contacts. This lady said she's not a natural networker, but maybe the one next to her is. So ask them. So if your friends say, do you know somebody who could help me? Ask a polite question. But don't say thanks very much, bye. Don't do that. Value them. Keep in touch with them. You will always be surprised by the value of your contacts. Our best work at Results CIC has been through surprise contacts. We didn't expect a conversation over coffee to lead to a fantastic 4-year contract, but it did. Also, an equally important, value yourself. Now, a diagram, you wouldn't believe how long it took me to draw this. Absolutely hopeless with computers, but I want to try to show you in some way what happens to your emotional range and depth when you experience tough times, when you scare yourself, you do scary things. So, generally speaking, most days we kind of feel okay. Some of you maybe not, but the blue, pale blue area, you feel okay. What happens if it goes down beneath the line? So I put worse than you can imagine. What happens then? We die, or we don't. We stay alive somehow. What happens to our range, our capacity, our emotions? Anybody like to take a guess? We go down like that, and then? Can, absolutely, and definitely. I had mild depression during the discrimination, and it's a real so-and-so. And don't let anybody fob you off. If you're experiencing depression, get help. You need that, because everything looks dark when you're in there. But if you can find a way through, the good news is that from here, this looks fantastic. Your perspective changes, your range changes. So the pale blue becomes something much bigger. If you can reach that point, you have actually gained more resilience. You will have got basically a bigger emotional range. You can cope with the highs and the lows. But will you fit in? When I was trying to decide what to do at the Foreign Office, I was in a really boring temporary job when I'd been discriminated against. A friend, a female friend of mine who's a coach, she gave me a quote about this. I said, oh, it's a good job, it's government, you know, it's all stable. And she said, listen to this. if my curve is large, why bend it to a smaller circle? If my curve is large, why bend it to a smaller circle? Originally it was in Japanese, apparently. I thought, damn you woman, she's right. Because I realised from that quote, I was being constrained by the context I was working in. We all have the potential to choose the context in which we work, the frameworks. The good news is, the place you're in, it may not be perfect, it may not be ideal. Maybe your curve is a bit large, but you can probably have more influence on it than you realise. So think about what you could do, what you could say to just shift things slightly. Sometimes the small shifts can be tipping points. Be aware of your values there. If you feel you're working somewhere, or maybe studying somewhere, and there's too big a difference between your values and here, and their values, maybe think again. Remember your value. You are valuable. You need to care for yourself. Where could you use that best? I'm wondering if we've got time for this one. One to think about. I'm not going to have this as a discussion point, and I'm going to move on to the final point because of timing, okay? But it's a question for you to consider. You might want to write it down. The rules of your organisation and the culture, could they be creating barriers for you? Moving on, final section. Skipping on. How do you develop a successful social enterprise? Why did I end up doing this? I was invited to join Results CIC by Juan Watts and his colleague, but I'd taken the decision to jump out into the world of self-employment. It was the curve point, it was the framework, needing to work in a framework that suited me. If you're thinking of doing this, social enterprise is the biggest growing sector in the UK. It's a good reason to. It carries a lot of advantages between a charity and a business. You've got access to more funding streams, potentially in income streams. There are really good opportunities out there, but you need to think about why you're doing it. If you are contemplating this, what motivates you for the long haul, long term? Second question, really important, what you were talking about earlier. How can you use your specific combination of skills and experiences? What can only you do? What makes you really shine? Another very important question, what is success? And how can you use any resources you have to achieve that? Some people, success is money. Maybe social enterprise isn't for you, if so. It's not there primarily to generate financial profit, although it may do that. Who do you know who can help? Contacts, again. And what safety net do you have to keep you going? So answering those questions for us is from Results CIC. We choose to support, there we are, excluded people. We have our own experience of exclusion. We choose to support people who are excluded to achieve their potential. In terms of our experience, we're all disabled. Are you disabled? I can't see your peg leg. About hormones, is we have very different disabilities, sensory, and about mental health, and about long-term health condition. We're also from other minorities. So, and we've all worked at senior level, so we bring all that to the work as coaches and trainers. Success for us is reaching people who would not otherwise be able to get coaching and support. This is often something that's a bit of a privilege, maybe for senior people. But when we do coach deaf, disabled, unemployed, homeless, young, disenfranchised people, the improvement and the development is extraordinary. Sustainability, we have a social pricing scale, quite a wide scale, and we try to prioritise projects we feel we can achieve the best outcomes on. Where our skills would they really be relevant? And our ability to address this. So judging success, woo-hey! Look who's been to Oxfam. It was from Cancer Research. It's £7.50. That was Hormuz and I meeting, get this, the co-op funeral services. It's true. No, it was the National Diversity Awards as we found out. Here we are. we were the winners. We were really surprised and very honoured to receive an award. It's one way of looking at success. I've been named as one of the most influential people. We've been recognised by the ILM, the Institute of Leadership and Management. But is that success? Is it success? It's externally, people say, well, hey, they got an award. Look, she's in a sparkly dress. Brilliant. It is a form of success, but another way to look at success is the people we worked with and influenced. All of them from different minority groups. You said purple. Actually, that matches you. It's brilliant. That's purple. Spooky. Disabled and deaf primarily, but not only. Another way to look at success. How we use our resources. The final point there. Any surplus is recycled. We recycle the money so we keep a pot. And if people come to us with really high need in their resources, we can offer them coaching and pay ourselves. Some of the people we've worked with, you see, the University of Manchester, one of our biggest programmes, Liverpool, John Moores, we are definitely open to offers from Leeds. Very cheeky. You have to be cheeky in business. The project at the top has particular resonance at the moment. We worked with groups of recent refugees and staff at the Immigration Aid Unit. Wonderful, every single project we run, great experience. Another way to look at what happens, there's a self-assessment course from four programmes we run. And have a look at the headings down the left. Self-confidence, resilience, the ability to state your disability needs. That's what some people call disclosure. Look at the numbers. Generally about a third, 30% or higher improvement. The stories behind those numbers, though, are even more fantastic. I will never forget the day I walked into a coaching session with an ex-factory employee who was a sign language user, no voice. He'd worked in the factory for 30 years and they closed it. And he couldn't find a job. He didn't read very easily and well, but a very skilled, reliable person, and he came in, beaming, and said, I got a job through a contact, like we discussed, my network. You did? I remember feeling the hairs go off my arms, there was no feeling to compare to that, and his life transforming, and him becoming a role model for others. We have many stories like that. We're almost finished, but how could this help you? I can't tell you about the future, and I'm a definite optimist, otherwise I wouldn't be here. But there's a definite shift towards another way of looking at business and how we share resources and how we use the skills we have. Two quotes, one from the leader of a BMA program talking about empathy. Look at the bold phrase that we need empathy, we fall short as leaders. And we actually diminish our competitiveness and interesting. And empathy is all soft and cuddly stuff. We diminish our competitiveness unless we understand others. If you think about that for a moment, it actually makes sense. Know your enemy, you know. You have to understand others. And a longer quote there from the founder of the World Economic Forum. First line, let's have a look. Leaders need sensitivity and empathy to serve as their radar system. Values and vision as their compass. This is the WEF, this is DevOps, the big guys. Yeah. There's been a definite shift. Interesting to observe. Finally, a couple of key messages then. Maybe it's obvious, but when I reflected on that, there's actually no business which is separate from people and their feelings and their behaviour. Any business which assumes we can separate the two will detach from reality. It won't thrive long term. Think about the financial institutions that fell very quickly a few years ago. They detached from reality slightly. And also to lead well, we need to keep developing the self-awareness I talked about. Without it, avoidable toxic situations develop. They restrict our effectiveness. Almost finished. Future plans for results, CIC. We'd like to work not just with minority staff, but with their managers, we want to facilitate more open conversations. We feel that's key to people making the progression they need to. Also supporting cultural change, encouraging universities and organisations to listen to each other better, to develop a listening and coaching culture. We want to reach out to the private sector. Anybody here running a private sector company, we'd like to talk to you afterwards, please. Maybe it's yours. And finally, longer term, maybe within 10 years, look at training more coaches who are from minority groups, spreading the word. Now, over to you for one moment, please bear with me. I want you to have a think about what you've just heard. It's an hour of talk, 45 minutes, just have a bit of reflect. Now, ladies and gentlemen, think of one positive action you might want to make. Think about what you've heard. Listen to the talk. Any positive action you'd like to make could be tiny, could be to do with your vegetables or your cooking or your new skills or your contact matter. Think and write it down for yourself. Some people are sharing, that's nice. I won't ask you to share, although you might want to later. Two things before we finish. I like this, the idea that you can leave the door open for other people. Think about it. As you progress through your careers, you'll be very successful, I'm sure. Who are you leaving the door open to? Who are you encouraging? If you're a candle, you don't actually lose something by lighting another candle. And finally, I said earlier that I stopped being afraid of what people thought, and here is the evidence. Can I hear Oscar Wilde's voice? I love that quote. Be yourself, darling. Everybody else is taken. So I love dancing. You can ask Cornwalls as well. This was a significant birthday recently. And I was the lady in the right. It's a hilarious photo. But there's dancing to my own tune. That's why I included the photo. And I dance to my own tune, and I hope I may have inspired you this evening to do the same. So now's a chance to ask some questions, feedback. Some people don't like doing that, but we could do it outside, over a drink if you prefer. As I mentioned, my co-director, Hormoz Ahmadzadeh, is here as well. We're both available for a chat and further questions if you'd like. Thank you.